now these isolation practices are very important. We are all seeing a lot of ESBLs, we are seeing acinetobacter, we are seeing a lot of MDR infections. So we need to really know about isolation. And this season we are seeing a lot of viral bronchiolitis, probably influenza, probably RSV. So we need to know about isolation, something about spacing between the beds, because we don't have isolation facilities. And how do we space out the beds? Now, isolation and superbugs is a real major issue all over the world. In India, except India, where we have the largest amount of antibiotics being used left, right and center, we still don't seem to be very much worried about superbugs. Now, this was an article in Australia in February 2019, where they said that they will be starting to isolate patients who come from developing countries if they are harboring superbugs. So they are taking that extent of care that if anyone is just harboring a superbug, that patient will be isolated. This was an article in UK, again in 2014, that it's overloaded wards that are causing superbugs. And I think we are well aware about how we are handling overloaded wards, and we are a sitting hotbed for superbugs in our hospital. What are superbugs? Now, when you talk about superbugs, these are basically the same bugs that are not working. Your local antibiotics are not working in these bugs. So it's your gram-negative bacteria who are now become ESBLs. Your staphylococcus that has now become MRSA or a VRSA. VRE, that is vancomycin-resistant enterococcus. Even your MDR now becomes a, MDR-TB becomes a superbug. So any bacteria that is not sensitive to your first line antibiotics is known as a superbug. And what is the most important cause of transmission? It is because of understaffing and overcrowding. That's the most important cause of transmission from one person to the other. Especially, it's very easy to transmit in an ICU setup. So NICU, PICU, you'll have a lot of these bugs being transmitted to each other. General pediatric ward, if they are overcrowded, you will get these infections. Now, how does this transmission occur? This transmission will occur either airborne, depending on what type of infection it is. It will occur through contact, and most common is contact. So all your gram-negative bacteria, MRSA, is basically through contact. Direct or indirect contact. Now, the most common thing which I tell you is happening is, where does MRSA harbor? It's in your nose. Somebody puts his finger in the nose, then touches a lot of substances or touches a lot of people. And that's how your body is going to spread. So it's going to be a contact. The other is our stethoscopes, our phones. These are the places that the bugs are being harbored. And that's how we are transmitting them. Your rhinovirus and all that. They are sitting on the table, on the chair. Somebody had rhinorrhea, clenched it, kept his hand on the table, kept his hand on the chair. You see, no mother, they clean the nose and on their clothes they are wiping it. And then with that same hand it's going on various things. Now those viruses are sitting here, you touch that table, you're going to get the virus. That's why the hand hygiene is very important. Because still you don't take care of hand hygiene. India is a country where we have a very poor civic sense. So to develop that civic sense is going to take time. You can take your own precautions by being hygienic. Otherwise, all of you all, today if we take your rectal swabs and your anterior nasal swabs, you are all going to be harboring in superbug. You are all colonized with that. Droplet in airborne is another form of transmission that we have. Now, which viruses go through droplet? Your adenovirus. Droplet means it remains suspended in the air for some time and then it disappears. Okay, so adenovirus, influenza, rhinovirus, they come through droplet. That is why when you have these patients admitted in the ward, you are supposed to isolate them. And you are supposed to keep them airborne isolation. Contact, again, adeno and parainfluenza. So if somebody has got adenovirus, that adenovirus is there on your table. That adenovirus is there on your chair, on your stethoscope. That's how you're going to spread adenovirus. And airborne, SARS, influenza. Airborne is like an epidemic. You can't control it. It's there in the air. You can't just control it. So these are your airborne. The only way you can prevent it is you wear masks. So that's how you will control an airborne infection. Now, how do you prevent these kind of transmission? One is standard precautions. Now, what do you mean by standard precautions? If I can ask someone, can someone tell me what is a standard precaution? It's transmission-based precaution. Standard is you don't know whether the patient is infected or not. But any patient who comes to the hospital will take these standard precautions. Transmission-based precaution is where you suspect that this patient could be having RSV or this patient could be having influenza. And then how do you control it? So which infection agents you need to isolate? Right now, what the point of infection? Either it's diarrhea, etc., it's eccentric, or it's pneumonia. How are you going to isolate all of them? So infections that are readily transmissible, influenza, needs to be isolated. They have a tendency of causing an outbreak. Okay? May be associated with a severe outcome or are difficult to treat. These are the infections that you need to isolate. Now, for example, if we take hospital-acquired infections, Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas, ESBL, Klebsiella, Enterobacter, among your fungus, Aspergillus, Clostridium difficile patient also needs to be isolated. MRSA, VRSA, VRE, influenza virus, among your community-acquired infections, influenza virus, RSV, rotavirus, SARS, and MDR-TB and PLTB needs to be isolated. We have one isolation ward in which we have two wards. It's not possible for us to isolate so many patients. Right now, we must be having an epidemic of probably influenza, most of our patients. It's not possible to isolate all of them. So then, what do we do? One is we do standard precautions. What is this? That if you come in contact with any body fluid, blood, body fluid, secretions, except sweat, non-intact skin, suppose you've got a cut or a mucous membrane, then you have to take precautions that you don't get this infection. What does it contain? Hand hygiene is the most important thing. And depending on the type of exposure, you may wear gloves, you may wear a gown, you may wear a mask, you may wear goggles, you may even wear a face shield. Now, why are you supposed to use which kind of a standard precaution? I'll tell you. Additions to standard precautions now is also cough etiquette. You cannot cough on anyone's face. You have to cover your mouth and cough. That is cough etiquette. If you coughed, you need to wash your hands after coughing. Okay? Or you need to keep a tissue and cough and dispose of that tissue. So that's cough etiquette. Safe injection practices. Why these are now included in standard practices? Because of cough, a lot of patients are getting influenza. Okay, so that was the reason why cough etiquette came. Safe injection practices came for your hepatitis B and C. So safe injection practices means disposable syringes and needles. You dispose of the needle, you dispose of the syringe once you use. The needle has to be put in a plastic container which cannot be punctured. Puncture proof plastic container. So you dispose of that. And the most important thing now that has come is when you are doing a lumbar puncture, you are supposed to wear a mask. This is not for your protection. Don't expect that the CSF is going to splash in your face. But quite a few must be having a UR here. And there have been case reports where patients have got streptococcus pneumoniae from the doctor's nose into their spinal canal while they were doing the lumbar puncture. Okay, so if you have a spinal canal procedure like an epidural anesthesia or a myelomy or a lumbar puncture, doctors need to wear masks to prevent transmission to the patient. So it's not only gloves now, it's going to be masks. That's a standard precaution. So standard precautions, when do you wear gloves? If you're going to touch blood, body fluid, secretions, so if you're going to do suction, if you're going to change the IV line, if you're going to stop the wind flow, that's the time you're supposed to wear gloves. You are supposed to do hand washing before and wearing after the gloves. So it's not necessary that you do it only before. After you remove the gloves, also you're supposed to wash your hands. Gown is when you're expecting some splashes onto your clothes. That's the time you're going to wear gown. That's for your own protection. Again, face shield and mask is again when you expect a splash on your face or in your eyes. So especially when you're doing endotracheal intubation or you're doing suctioning, that's the time you should wear goggles and face mask. And needles, I told you, you have to put in a puncture-resistant container, plastic container, and cuff etiquette. Cuff etiquette, I have already spoken. Now, this is where your spacing of the beds comes into the picture. And I hope we have the matron here who is going to listen to that. Now, how do we do transmission-based prevention? Transmission-based prevention is when you have a suspicion that this patient is harboring this infection, or you have confirmed that infection. So it like you used to have epidemics of spine flu, you used to confirm the infection and then transfer the patient to Kasturba. Similarly, now you do system wise. So if a patient has diarrhea, this child will probably be having cholera, this child will be probably having rotavirus. Now these can be transmitted by contact. So you need to do contact precautions for them. That's the kind of isolation that you're supposed to do. For meningitis, basically you're worried about Neisseria meningitis because that will be through droplet. It's present in your nose. So even if a child has Neisseria meningitis, it will be present in your nose. So you need to take care of droplet precautions for the first 24 hours, especially if you're going to intubate the patient. Then you need to wear a face and a mask, face mask and face protection. Enteroviruses. Enteroviruses causes meningitis. Enteroviruses is like a poliovirus. Poliovirus is also a type of enterovirus. So it comes in your stool. So if you are going to have a patient with enterovirus meningitis, you have to take contact precautions. So you have to wear gloves. Tuberculosis. Airborne precautions. You have to wear a mask. If you are going to be in touch with body fluid of that patient, say for example, pleural fluid, or lymph node biopsy, or a CSF that you've done, you have to wear contact precautions, so gloves. So airborne precautions and contact precautions. If you have herpes zoster or you have herpes simplex or varicella zoster, it is airborne. Though it is a skin rash, it is airborne. So you have to have airborne precaution plus a contact precaution. If you are going to have rubella or measles, again, airborne precaution. And respiratory, what we are having right now, respiratory. Airborne precaution plus contact precaution. Because I told you about the respiratory virus, some are transmitted airborne, some are droplet, and some are through contact. So you need to do both contact as well as airborne precaution. Now what is contact precaution? Ideally, for a contact, so if you have a patient with diarrhea, you have a patient with a respiratory illness, you have a patient with meningitis, ideally this patient should be in a single room. If it's not possible and you are going to have multiple patients in one room, you need to cohort these patients. Means diarrhea patients go in one room, respiratory patients go in one room. And the distance between their beds should be 3 feet. Healthcare professionals should wear a gown and a glove for contact precaution. If you are going to have a patient who has a DRE, Clostridium, ESBL, which all comes through contact, MRSA, you have to wear all the gown, gloves, everything before you enter the room. You have to remove all that before you exit the room. It should not be discarded after you exit the room. So even in the PICU or in the NICU, when you enter, you're supposed to enter wearing it, discard it before you come out. Okay, that's your contact precaution. Droplet precaution. Droplet is influenza, pertussis, adenovirus, rhinovirus, group-based streptococcus. Single room again is preferred. If you can't, keep a 3 feet space between the beds, and there should be curtains between the beds. So if you want to have a droplet precaution, there has to be curtains. You cannot keep a curtain where the beds are 1 feet apart from each other, and the curtain will also be harboring a lot of germs which will be through your contact. And you need to wear a mask for droplet before you enter the room. Airborne. Tuberculosis, measles, varicella, SARS. For airborne infections, we actually need an airborne infection isolation room. It's known as AIIR. Here you need to wear a mask, probably an N95 respirator, before you enter into the room. Now I'll show you how you're supposed to do all these precautions. Now what do you mean by airborne infection isolation room? How is it different from contact and droplet precaution? It's a negative pressure room. So when anyone enters into the room, air from outside is included inside the room. The air from the room is not going outside. So no influenza from that room will go outside. corridor air has to come inside. It has to be a single patient room. Here there is no question that you can mobile these patients. These patients have to be kept in isolation. The air has to change 6 to 12 times per hour. You and I are sitting in the AC. We don't even know how many times the air is changing. There are so many times when we come to know that somebody got TB. There's no family contact and there's hydrocanic TB sitting in the chair. How did he get it? He got it through an airborne route. And how did he get it? Because probably he was in a room which didn't have these kind of air chambers. So if you're going long distance air travel, where you're going to sit in the aircraft for 10 to 12 hours, that aircraft has to have a change of air more than 6 to 12 times an hour. Otherwise, international traveling is the commonest cause of influenza spread, International travel is also how SARS spread. But why everybody didn't get infected is because the air changes keep on taking place. Okay? And how do you discard out that infected air? That discarded, infected air has to be discarded outside the building. Or if it's going to recirculate. Now your AC is currently in a recirculation mode. That means the air from inside is recirculating again and again. You also have ACs where you change the length, then air from outside may come. But most of the times your ACs are in a recirculating mode. So if you have an AC in that kind of a room, you need to have a HEPA filter. This HEPA filter is going to filter out most of the particles which are less than 5 microns and it's going to keep the air sterile. So in your NICUs, in your PICUs, you actually need HEPA filters because the air recirculation is actually taking within the air, within the room. So I don't know whether we have HEPA filters here or not, but this is what we're supposed to have. It's for your own protection also. So just putting on the ventilator, a HEPA filter is not enough. You need to have a HEPA filter in the room. And that's what I told you, cohorting. When you can't isolate these patients, groups of patients, all diarrheas can be cohorted together, all respiratory can be cohorted together, and you can prevent contact with other people. Now, let us talk about fungal infections a little bit. We don't have bone marrow transplant unit here, but we do have a lot of neoplastics, we do have a lot of leukemia patients who are neutropenic and they will get fungal infections. So these patients actually have to have a lot of environmental control. So you need to, what we discussed about AIR is HEPA filter for expired air. Okay? Here in these patients it has to be HEPA filter of incoming air also. Because your aspergillus spore is there, your mucor spore is there, they have to be filtered out. There has to be a directed room airflow. It's positive pressure. Because here the patient is not infected. We are trying to prevent infection in the patient. So the room has to be positive pressure. So you don't want anything coming from the corridor. You want all the air from inside going out. The room should be well sealed. More than 12 air changes per hour. And you have to minimize dust. So there should be no carpets, no curtains. It only has to be scrubbable surfaces. The sprinklers, the crevices have to be cleaned and there should be no potted plants, flowers in the room. So this is the care that you will take for leukemia patients who are non-infected but are neutropenic and for patients who are aplastic or those with transplant. That's what you are going to do for these patients. So this is the kind of personal protection equipment that you are going to do. When you first enter the room, first is you wear a gown. When you wear a gown, you fasten at the neck and then the waist. Okay, this is the way you're supposed to wear a gown. Then you wear a mask. Okay, you have to make sure you completely seal this area. It should not be open from your ear. It has to be sealed. It should fit snugly. And if you're using an N95 mask, you get sizes of the N95 mask. You have to see that it fits you properly. N95 is no use if the air is going from the side. Goggles, face shield. So first gown, then mask. Then goggles are a face shield and then gloves. Okay, that's the way you're supposed to wear your protective equipment, one after the other. And when you come out, you have to, before you come outside, after you leave the patient, before you leave the patient's room, in the anteroom, you're supposed to first remove the gloves. Because your contact has taken place, so first remove the gloves. The way that you're supposed to remove the gloves is from the inside because your outside is contaminated. So this is a figure that shows you have to grasp the glove outside, peel it off, slide the fingers of the ungloved hand inside and remove the glove. Then comes out your goggles. Again, don't touch here because this is contaminated. Touch at the sides. Okay, and remove your goggles. Then gowns, your front and the sleeves are contaminated. So don't remove your gowns like this. Remove your gowns from the back. Okay, remove the gowns that way. And then finally comes out your mask. Again, the mask has to be from the sides you touch and you remove. Don't remove your mask like that. So that's the way you're supposed to. When you go inside, gown, mask, goggles and gloves. When you come outside, gloves, goggles, gown and mask. That's the way you're supposed to take care of precautions, especially in isolation. Now for superbugs, MRSA, PRSA, ESPLs. Contact precautions have to be taken care of, so gowns and gloves should come. Then these patients should be isolated in a single room. If not, you cohort these patients. If the transmission is still taking place, say in the ICU, the transmission is still taking place, you get the patient in one room, it's still taking place, then you need to keep a dedicated staff for that. You cannot have that same staff looking after all the patients, otherwise contact is going to take place. So your nursing staff and ancillary staff should be dedicated for that patient. If it's still the transmission is taking place, you have to stop admissions to that society, that unit. There is no role of fumigation. I mean, fumigation nowadays, nobody recommends doing fumigation of the ICU. These are what you're supposed to do to get that organism out. And you stop the admissions to that particular unit. If after that also, if it does not work, then you have to close the unit. And then probably you have to consider this fumigation. Okay, but this is what you will have to do. I don't think we ever isolate the patient. I don't think we even have a dedicated staff looking after this patient. So for us, the easy way out is fumigate the isolation. That's the end of the story. So this is about isolation practices. When you do isolation practices, remember contact precautions, remember droplet, remember airborne. When do you need curtains? When do you need to keep the patient completely isolated in a negative pressure room? And when do you need to